Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Collapse by Matthew Peed. Narrated by Gabriel Vaughan and Eva Kaminsky. Chapter 1. Regan. I looked at the new tower built at the center of the city of Tear Falls that was steadily sending mana into my core. There were easily another 400,000 people here that were sending nearly twice that number in mana to my cores. I didn't hide this fact while I was building the structure, and even gained quite a few new followers in the process. Of course, they'd never seen anything quite like this. With the situation in the east handled for the moment, I decided to focus on the moon. I didn't like the idea of something that could so easily repel one of my ships sitting up there. Plus, it had been nearly a month since the Lycal had joined me at the station. I needed to handle that situation as well. I had a few plans I was working to implement, but I would need to make sure everything was prepared before I did anything. Space is dangerous no matter what universe you're in. I imagine a universe with monsters and magic would be even more so. I needed to make sure Louella and my other assets on the surface were able to handle me being gone for a few days. With Louella being the biggest pin keeping the mortals in a semblance of normalcy after all that had happened, she would be top on my list. She was doing a good job with organizing the survivors she found. While a large section of the east had been devastated, the southern part was largely intact. It would be interesting to see how that would go. From the information I had, the main church of Laloon was located in the Port of Hope. They would have a better time fighting the undead than the other cities farther north, and would be less inclined to accept her aid. With Prince Charles handing over Lecazar to Louella, we managed to avoid a lot of bloodshed. When I got a report on the situation from Puppet and the other children, it said they were mostly in favor of the prince. Azra didn't like him, but that was more a personal issue, from what I gathered. I felt he would make a good regent for the area once Louella reclaimed the Lecazar Empire. I would, of course, be keeping an eye on the prince, as would Louella, no doubt. She wasn't naive enough to trust someone just from their words. Having your country destroyed tends to allow a person to reshuffle their priorities. But being born into royalty was something people generally struggled to relinquish. Earth was full of examples. Even if Prince Charles did state that he had known about this happening for a long time now, it could just be nice words during this time of hardship.
Regan.
I heard my name just as something slammed into my back. When I looked around, Alara was clinging to me. The dungeon core had wormed her way into my metal heart. Not that I had tried to keep her out. I had just stopped caring if it was magically induced or natural. Alara, what is it? I asked, worried about her. She was still recovering and would sometimes have rather intense mood swings. My main concern right now was her speech. She was still struggling to talk even after nearly a month. I remembered stories of people refusing to talk for the rest of their lives and was thankful she wasn't that bad off.
Missed you,
she said, rubbing her face into my back. How she could enjoy rubbing her face into my metal body, I couldn't understand. I was only gone a few hours, I said with a chuckle.
Too long.
I laughed as I grabbed her waist and pulled her onto my shoulders. Compared to my current avatar of close to 4 meters tall, her form, only 152 centimeters, was severely dwarfed. Being a dungeon core avatar, though, she was probably capable of tossing my body several hundred meters if she tried. What do you want to do? I have a few hours before anything needs my attention. We were currently on the station, the location of all my more advanced magic tech that allowed me to more efficiently control the 5 subcores I currently operated. If I'd tried to do it manually, I would have missed many of the non-threatening things that happened in my aura.
I want to build something,
she said, kicking her feet excitedly. Sure, that sounds like fun. Do you have enough mana to spare? She was still recovering her dungeon from nearly a century of tainted unholy mana. It was a long and grueling process that required as much mana as it brought in from the cleansing. I had forces in her dungeon that were killing the risen undead, but with over 80 floors to deal with, it took a while.
I've been saving. Want to make child with you, she said.
I glanced up at her and saw she was blushing. I smiled in reply. That was one of the most fascinating things about her. She would alternate so quickly from childlike to adult, it could make one's head spin. That sounds like fun. I spanned my fingers, and a golden portal opened that led to her core room. This would normally be very rude, or downright lead to a war between cores. Ignea had explained it to me when Lena had started freaking out once. However, as I had technically conquered Alara's core, I was allowed to do so. Plus, I don't think she truly minded.
Master Regan, Mother!
Lena called as she flew over to us. With Alara always with me, the fairy tended to watch over her dungeon in the meantime. That's not to say Alara was lazy. Dungeon cores didn't sleep, but due to the massive amount of cleansing she constantly needed to do, she needed to separate her mind from her dungeon for periods of time. The best way to do that was by sleeping near my core. Alara held her arms out, and Lena flew into them. She hugged the fairy with a smile. Everything good down here? I asked the little fairy.
Yes, Master Regan. We managed to reclaim floor 79 today. My mother just needs to repopulate it with her children, and it will be good as new,
Lena replied, giving me a salute. Lena, I've told you just to call me Regan, I said with a chuckle at the little creature's actions.
I know.
She glanced at Alara.
But I'll stick to Master Regan.
She took off to a little alcove that was inside a tree. What did you say to her? I asked, glancing at Alara.
Nothing,
she said with a pout. I decided to let it drop for now, on account of her looking stupidly cute when she made that face. I'd already accepted the fact that she was probably going to get me killed by her cuteness one of these days. We took a walk through the floors to check their progress. While she could alter them once she had full control of them, her creatures were of nature persuasion. That meant they had to grow the old-fashioned way. While normally she would have likely fueled their growth with mana, at the present, she didn't have the mana to spare. She had 94 floors, with her core being on the 95th. The first 10 before her core, she'd returned to a forest that encompassed the entire 10 floors. Creatures ran around, making a natural ecosystem inside the floors. Treants, bears, deer that could tear a man apart, nature spirits, and much more. It looked like even though she had been a prisoner and was forced to create the undead for nearly a century, she hadn't forgotten her roots. No pun intended. In fact, some of the creatures in there would have given my minions of the same tier a good run for their money. So, what do you want to create? I asked once we reached an empty glade on our walk.
I don't care as long as we can do it together,
she replied, wrapping her arms around my head. I chuckled. All right. How about a sort of caretaker for your forests?
Treant?
She asked, confused. Similar, but different. Smaller, more able to interact with the mortal races. On Earth, there were stories of creatures that would protect the forest alongside the treants and nymphs. They were man-shaped and man-sized, but considerably more powerful. Some called them druids, others forest golems. I couldn't think of a way to convey all that in words, so I pulled her head down and placed my forehead against hers. I accessed the memories and ideas, much like a file, and sent them to her mind. I couldn't have done this if we hadn't been in our avatar bodies. You needed a physical medium to understand the information. The magic in this world was very intuitive as well. Just take the books in the library, for example. There was no way I knew all that from Earth perfectly. But using magic, I could recreate the information for a mana cost. I had wondered at the entity behind it all, then remembered creation and decided to just roll with it.
Beautiful,
Alara said. I nodded. The legends and stories from Earth always included a massive forest with these beings. By using this method, she was quite literally shown the memories, which meant she saw forests that were as large as a continent. It was one of the sad points from Earth. There had been few forests left when I was born. Even with my drones, Earth was close to tipping past the point of no return. Understand? She nodded slowly before she hopped off my shoulder. She stood and raised her arms wide. A magic circle, much like the one that forms when I use the dungeon magic gifted to me by some other being, formed. I saw it start to flicker and knew she wouldn't have enough mana to create something of this complexity. I stepped forward, shrinking my form in the process, then kneeled next to her. Placing my hand on her back, I began transferring mana to her. After all, she'd wanted to create something together. If my mana was put into the magic, then it would have features I was partial to. I did make sure not to overpower her mana. With a crack, the summoning was finished. Alara and I stepped back to take in the creation. A tall being that seemed to be made partially from metal and partially from wood stood at over 3 meters. It had long limbs and arms that nearly touched the ground. While it looked powerful, I would say it had a docile feeling to it. Alara gave a cry of happiness, then ran forward, jumping up and down as she circled it several times. I smiled at her cuteness. I didn't want to get in the middle of the excited dungeon core and her new creation, so I stood back and watched.
He is beautiful,
Alara cried. I blinked when her speech wasn't halted like it had been for weeks now. Anything that you make would be beautiful.
Thank you, Mother, for giving me life,
the creature said, bending down to kneel in front of her. He held out a hand to her, and a flower grew from the moss covering him. He offered it to her, and she took it gently. And quite intelligent, too, I said with a grin. He looked over to me, then asked,
Would you prefer I call you Father or Master Regan?
I blinked, but before I could reply, Alara answered for me.
You will call him Father.
Yes, that does seem appropriate, I added, trying not to laugh.
Then, Mother, Father, I shall attend to the garden,
he said, before he turned and started to walk away. As he stepped, there was a surge of nature mana into the surrounding plants that helped them grow for a few minutes. A tree rose by almost a meter just from the time he was standing there. Now I know why they never stopped moving in the stories, I said, following him with my eyes. If he stopped, he would likely be trapped by the plants that grew around him. I suddenly felt something hit me in the chest and went from standing to lying on the ground.
Thank you,
Alara said, rubbing her face against my shoulder. It was fun. I won't have much time to spare you in the future weeks, so I want to spend some time beforehand, I said honestly. I reached up and smoothed out her hair. It was like silk in my hand, and I had to resist the urge to play with it. Alara grabbed my hand and held it against her cheek, repeating,
Thank you.
I got into a sitting position while I shifted her onto my lap. She cuddled in closer. I knew she had lived even longer than I had with both my lives combined, but she appeared so fragile that I felt I needed to protect her from the world. I just enjoyed the moment with her in my arms.
Chapter 2. Louella. I cracked my neck as I looked over the latest reports. I'd finally broken down and let my assistant take over some of the paperwork. The city was just getting too large for me to handle it all on my own. While most of the major decisions were still being made by me, many of the more tedious decisions I had left to her. With the traffic between Tear Falls and Videtta, we'd had to add mages to channel mana into the storage stone for the portals. It recharged automatically, but unfortunately, it wasn't fast enough. That was only one of the many changes we'd had to make in the last few days to accommodate the growing queendom. Many people had volunteered to join the army or city guard, which allowed Azal more people to work with. It was a blessing, as the security of the city was getting close to tipping. Any more, and I would have to ask Regan for some of his soldiers. He'd already upped the power of his obelisks, but there were just so many people. How many does that make? I asked, laying down the report. As of this morning, 235. All sent to Lord Regan's correctional facility, one of the assistants replied. I wasn't in my office anymore, but in a nearly hall-sized room that had several dozen people all working. Around me were the senior members of this little group I'd put together. It was just inefficient to work in an office, as people walked in and out constantly. I did have ways to make this a private space if need be. I wish there was more we could do, but there are few checks we can make on board the airships. Major James's image said from one of the pads on my desk. It was a miniature image that let me talk to the man without delay. Another gift from Regan. I understand, Major. Everyone goes through processing here. Don't worry about trying to catch the rats while dealing with so many people. Keep up the good work, I said with what I hoped was an understanding smile. It was hard to interrogate people when your main mission was rescuing them. There would be no end to it if they had to question every person they brought on board. Understood, Your Highness. Then we are currently 10 hours from the first southern city. They shouldn't have seen any undead yet. Don't try to push them. If it looks like they are well prepared, turn east and head for the next city. I don't want to pull the overly laloon-controlled cities into something we really can't afford to deal with right now. Yes, he replied with a salute. Then the image dissipated. I took a deep breath and grabbed the next report. This is in regard to the schools, Your Highness. The number of children is getting too high for the number of teachers to deal with. The headmaster is worried that the quality of education might start dropping. I read the finer detail, then nodded. Increase the budget for the education section. Make sure to mark that it is to be used on finding and recruiting teachers. Add an expansion to the school to the list. It is either madness or genius to live in a dungeon, she said, as she added the information to her glass tablet. Regan would be able to see what it said and could decide whether he wanted to do it or not. He usually managed to get us a reply within 12 hours. I'm fairly certain it's both, I commented. That's how the morning went with my staff and I dealing with the clerical functions of the city. In the future, this would all be dealt with by various departments and subdivisions. But it was looking like that was quite a ways away. The glass tablet dinged as I got a message from someone. I really had to thank Regan for the thing. It made communication around the city tremendously easier. He gave the devices to us to manage the Queen's District buildings, but had made some alterations at my request when I told him how useful they would be. So much parchment saved with this magical device. There was even a section that dealt with calculations. It was marvelous, to say the least. Cassie's voice came out of the tablet. My lady, there are some interesting adventurers here that I feel you should meet. I'm done for the morning. I'll be there in half an hour, I sent back. Putting the glass tablet into a special pouch, I turned to the assistants. I'll be back in a few hours. Keep up the good work. Yes, Your Highness, they all replied, saluting. I nodded, then collected my guards, and we left the castle. In the carriage, it only took a few minutes to arrive at the Adventurer's Guild, which had grown again. It looked like Cassie had hired one of the builders that had gotten a hold of some of Regan's building techniques. The crowd of adventurers parted from me. I tried to ignore the murmuring of my nickname, Storm Queen. While it spoke of power, I wasn't sure if I deserved it, since most of my power had been gained through Regan. Not that I was complaining, but I was worried about the future. I was shown to Cassie's office, which was nearly an entire floor on its own now. I glanced around as I made my way in. Been shopping? I asked. There were weapons, armor, tools, and all manner of other things lining and filling every surface in the room, not to mention spilling over onto the floor. I could sense mana lingering on just about every surface of the objects. Being the most successful adventurer's guild master has its perks, including the pay. Though, I think I love this thing the most, Cassie said, holding up the glass tablet. Regan had started to sell them at his tower, along with several more versions of the cultivating stone, with certain requirements, of course. Thanks to those, the average tier in the valley was 2, before all the newcomers. I patted my pouch. Indeed. I don't think I could live without it anymore. Cassie laughed. Let me call in my guests. They were supposed to arrive months ago. Before the tournament, in fact. But some business in another town delayed them. She tapped something into the tablet. A few minutes later, a group of 3 people were shown in. 2 were beastkin, while the 3rd was a good-looking human. I was getting a feeling of massive power from each of them. Allow me to introduce the Ardent Lords, the best adventurers in Thonica for the last 4 years. They've been doing some quests in Lecazar for about a year now, though, trying to earn a name there as well. Your Highness, the male beastkin said with a bow. He grabbed the girl's head and made her bow as well. The human just stared at me, and I was afraid he was mentally challenged despite his good looks.
Nero, what are you doing? Said the beastkin.
The human, Nero, I guessed, blinked, then walked over to me without hesitation. My guards reacted and pointed their swords at him with deadly intent. He glanced at them, and I saw true power. Power that I'd only seen a few times. I was reminded of Regan for a moment. Not sure of his intent, I stepped forward, flaring my mana around me. He stopped at once.
Excuse me, I meant no disrespect. I only wanted to ask you to be my bride, Nero said, going to one knee.
I backed away, disturbed by the sudden change. Who fucking proposes after only just meeting someone? I couldn't think of anything to say, but didn't have to, as the male beastkin shot forward and smashed his fist over the back of Nero's head. Either he was very skilled, or he had gotten in a lucky shot, as Nero dropped face first into the carpet.
My apologies. This idiot doesn't know when to shut up.
It's all right. What is your name?
You know, Your Highness. This is Sarah, my younger sister. The idiot on the floor is Nero.
Your sister? I asked. I looked between the two of them and only barely made out any family resemblance. Of course, it might have been the beastkin features making it hard for me to tell. His were quite prominent, but hers were almost non-existent. He was deeply tanned, while she was almost deathly pale. He gave a low, obviously humorless laugh.
We get that a lot, but she is most definitely my sister.
I meant no disrespect. It is a pleasure to meet you all. I assume you are here to dive the dungeon.
Sort of. Do you know what happened to the celestial that attacked your valley a few months back?
Morka. She's in the dungeon, I replied. It wasn't a big secret. Those 2 dragons came out at least once a week now and took a walk through the damn valley.
She is a celestial, right?
Yuno asked with narrowed eyes. Ask Lord Regan. She's technically his right now, I replied with a shrug. The room suddenly shook from something exploding. I turned to see Sarah lying spread-eagle and staring at the hole in the wall. Judging from the angle, she was the one who'd caused it. She turned to Yuno.
That was awesome!
I rubbed my temple when I saw she wore almost the same maniacal grin that Julie made when she was around Regan. I noticed her mouth was smoking. The girl must have tried to eat something.
My tolo beans! Those were expensive and meant for an emergency, Cassie cried, when she saw what was in the girl's hand.
Tolo beans were a natural explosive. I was amazed she'd survived putting something like that in her mouth. Yuno sighed before handing Cassie a handful of white gold. I started to wonder if they were the most active of the parties coming to the valley to pay for the actions of these 2. Looks like the dungeon is about to see some true challengers, I commented.
Yes. We will be diving in the coming days. We just need to gather some more information,
Yuno said, nodding.
Cassie, do you know where the Chaos Party is staying? That normally would have been a breach in etiquette, but Cassie liked people to call her by her nickname. Main Street Inn. No, actually, I think they're renting two rooms over in the Regis complex.
Thank you. We'll be on our way.
Yuno bent down and threw Nero over his shoulder before grabbing Sarah by her collar and dragging her out of the room. Well, that was interesting, I said after they left. And I thought the chaos party was bad, Cassie muttered. Keep an eye on them. We don't need any more irregulars around here causing problems, I said after turning back to Cassie. She shook her head. They're not exactly the kind of people you can just have tailed. I'm sure you have your ways.
That I do.
Very well. I shall keep an eye on them. Though, if something happens, I'll make sure to haunt you, Cassie said with a cat-like grin.
Chapter 3. Regan. All the activity came to a stop in the valley, steel spire and tear falls, as the snows got too strong for the areas. I thought I'd seen deep snow on Earth, but this was ridiculous. Outside the cities, the ground was covered almost 3 meters deep, and it only got deeper the farther from the heat you got. The north was almost completely buried. I suppose it shouldn't have come as a big surprise, given that mana played such a strong role in every aspect of this universe. While I didn't pay it much mind, the summer I'd lived through had certainly gotten to hotter temperatures than Earth would have seen. I would need to research it over a few decades to see how much celestials' bodies played a part. Fire mages appeared to be in great demand everywhere as they worked to melt the snow. From the few scenes I'd witnessed, they made sure the other mages knew it. All in all, everything was rather peaceful for the time being. From the few scout satellites I'd gotten in place around the valley, it was clear that even the undead were relatively unable to pass the snow and ice. We had tracked a few, what I like to call nests, of undead. I believed they were naturally forming, as I couldn't find any evidence that necromancers were involved. Based on what we'd learned from the beastkin that recovered some of their intellect, these were more of a problem than the necromancers truly were. The snows freed up a bit of my time to work on a looming threat, quite literally, in fact, as the moon loomed over the station. Its orbit was bringing it closer to the station's location by the day. I would have to deal with it, whether I was ready or not. While doing it at the station would provide more resources to work with, I risked the station if it went sideways. Jarvis, situation report.
Sir, our sensors are showing an increased buildup of energy on and under the surface of the moon. Whatever is there is very active, the holographic image of Jarvis reported.
I nodded, then leaned back, staring idly at the device. I'd increased the level of technology around the valley in an effort to raise the levels of the mortals around me. I was only one dungeon core, constantly working on something, and even more often being pulled this way and that. My effort to save Alara had shown that there were systems in place in the world that would result in me being cut off from my dungeon for spans of time. I trusted Louella. Having worked with her for several months now, I believed that she was the sort of mortal I wouldn't mind spreading my technology to. That being said, I had a backdoor program in all the tablets that let me monitor everything they were being used for. I had been betrayed in the past. I would be a fool to let it happen again. I was confident in my ability to survive anything thrown at me, and even if something were to happen to my main core, I had redundancies in place. It never hurt to be too careful. Thinking about the valley reminded me of Luella's bloodless win with the Lecazar bloodline. It might not be a bad path to take in the future when possible. I wonder, can I communicate with whatever is on the moon? Jarvis perked up at my comment.
Given the sophistication shown by the golems that boarded the ship, I believe the possibility will be high. However, without knowing their directives, it could be quite dangerous.
He was right. If they were constructed to keep the planet at a certain level, then our communicating with them would be like painting a target on our backs. Keep me posted. We don't need any surprises. Yes, sir. I moved over to the shipyard. With my mining floors going full throttle, I was currently sitting at a fleet of 25 ships of the battleship or cruiser size. I also was working on two carriers. They were much larger and were taking a while to assemble. As I was conserving mana, they were being built by hand. Add to that all the fighters, frigates, bombers, and minor vessels being built, the station was always a hive of activity. Soldiers were being assembled in another bay, all equal to Tier 2, with capabilities to fight Tier 3 if they worked together and had the proper equipment. Yulin, how are the goblins and gnomes acclimating to space? I asked the goblin overseer. After I'd built Tearfall Tower, the tower in Tearfalls, I'd moved them up here as I promised I would. A few goblins came along, as there were magics that I wanted tested in void environments.
Master, everything is smooth sailing. The Lycor are friendly, not to mention fast learners. The gnomes and goblins enjoy their time up here. I would like to report that a few dozen have had to return to the surface. They couldn't handle the emptiness of the void.
Is that so? I was hoping with the facilities on the station they would be able to cope. I'd built parks, entertainment, recreational options, and many other things that they could spend time doing while not attending to their duties. Along with the fully artificial gravity, I was hoping they would be able to handle the station.
With the portals, it really isn't that big of an issue, Master. We were considering setting up rotations to preemptively handle the stress.
I hadn't thought about that. Truly, with the portals, the surface of the planet was literally a hop and a skip away. It might have been a mana expenditure, but considering they were using established portals, the cost wasn't too high if several dozen went through at a time. That sounds splendid. Go ahead with the plan. Where is Azora?
She should be in the range, Master.
Thank you. I moved to the range, a large facility set up to allow my people to practice with various types of weapons. Standing at the edge, I saw Azora flying through the air with over a dozen shadowy figures on her tail. She was ducking and weaving as blasts of mana exploded in the air around her. A small reactive barrier countered the blasts. I was impressed with her use of magic, as it allowed her to conserve mana while still blocking the damage. She banked and came around, leveling her lance at the shadow figures. Firing rapidly, she released bolts of mana into the coming figures. They blasted apart if they were struck in the head or chest. Once she passed through the group of enemies, only three were left, with varying mock injuries. She didn't make out injury-free, though, and blood dripped from a cut on her shoulder. Motes of light formed around her a moment later. Within the time span of a blink, the motes shot toward the remaining figures and burned holes through them. The figures fell to the ground, but broke apart before they hit the surface. With the battle over, Azora fell to the ledge and landed. I clapped at her show of skills. She'd always been a good fighter, but she was taking to flight and aerial combat well. Maybe if things had gone a different way, the gnomes would have eventually developed wings, given their love of the skies.
Lord Regan, it's been a while.
Azora said with a curtsy when she saw me. Forgive me, matters around the world are keeping me busy. I am pleased to see my head priestess training so hard. What spurred this on? I asked, looking around the range once again. Given the amount of damage I saw, she must have been at it for several hours.
I heard a nasty rumor,
I heard her mumble. Pray tell. I was curious what could cause her to be so annoyed. Several emotions played across her face for a good minute.
A certain necromancer is being called your angel. It's disgusting, she shouted finally.
You must be talking about Julie, I said with a chuckle.
Why didn't you send me? I could have been your herald, she cried while extending her wings.
The light reflected off the gray-black surface. Mana appeared to be pulled into them. Purpose. Frankly, she suited the situation better. Yours was here with your people. She noticeably deflated. Azora was one of the most rational people I had met on the planet. I knew this was more of an emotional outburst. Basically, she was jealous. That someone was jealous of Julie, though, I shook away the thought.
I understand. I still want to serve you as more than a figurehead, she said with a small voice.
Glad you feel that way. I have a job for you, I said, placing my hands behind my back.
What is it?
I need someone to be my face in the city of Tear Falls. There are a large number of potentials there. With my gaze turned to the stars, I will not be able to be as active as I would like. Do you think your people will be able to handle themselves without you?
They basically are, anyway. I am only a queen in name. It may as well be a ceremonial title.
I looked her over. Recent events had really thrown the gnomes for a loop. Not only did they lose their city, but also their queen and king in a span of a few months, not to mention the large number of gnomes that left the city during the mutiny. They were in a rough place. Their princess-turned-queen was doing her best to deal with that. Then choose who you want to go with you. One of your main tasks will be to find the location of a dungeon that was near there. The Adventurers Guild will have information on it.
I think Vern would have more information than they would. She's lived and breathed dungeons for the last 70 years of her life.
Ah, the crazy one, I said, thinking about the only person to be level with the challenges. I had her writing whole books at this point. If she wanted to, she could reach the floating island's floor, given the library rules. She would have to go alone, as that was different from the regular challenge rules. Isora chuckled.
She can be a little focused at times. She knows her stuff, though.
I didn't say otherwise. I rather like her kind, willing to go to such lengths for knowledge. I think she and Luna are good friends now.
Yes, her reports often have large sections involving the library's guardian.
Then find out what you can from her. Tell me what you learn on your tablet. Next, I want you to take an airship over the ocean. There are a few items I want you to deposit for me.
Deposit, Lord?
The world is changing. The quakes grow worse by the day. They are only causing minor inconveniences at the moment, but sooner or later, real damage will result. I need to know everything I can about the situation. The items are devices that will allow me to get information about the area they are dropped in.
I understand. Anything else?
Isora asked, her gaze never faltering from mine. Just that all people are welcome to me. I don't care if they're a beastkin, elf, human, or whatever. If they follow me, then I shall welcome them with open arms.
Some of the races might have issue with that, but many will be quite thankful, particularly the slaves,
Isora said, nodding. The slaves were a pitiful lot. They had zero control over their destinies. Part of that was the magic that bound their souls. Whoever created it was a nasty fellow. The best I could do was change the target of the master to me. If they were never issued an order, then it was close to being free. Still, for them, it must have been like walking around with a hatchet to the neck. At least it wasn't passed down the family line. Their children would be free. I will make you one of the devices that I gave Louella and a few members of the Freedom Guild in Steel Spire. They can use it to overwrite the master in the slave brand to myself. That will pull you in a few followers.
I agree, my lord.
I discussed a few more things with Isora before she left to gather her people. I mainly did not want a situation like with Morka to happen while I was busy dealing with the moon. I'd learned from that mishap and would not let it happen again. I had already upgraded the defenses around all of my cores. I wasn't actually sure how powerful one would need to be in order to defeat them. Take care. I will be back to check on you in a few days.
Of course, my lord. May your trip be fruitful, Isora said with a bow.
Leaving the range, I concentrated on the next person on my list. Ignia was helping Ren around the Beastkin village deeper in the dungeon. After nearly a month in the dungeon, they were finally showing improvement. There was a lot of aggression still, but Ren wasn't taking it lying down. She'd already reached End Tier 2 while in the dungeon, which was considerable, given how she'd been just months ago. Moving over to the village, I found the two of them talking about some buildings that needed to be added to the village. Ignea saw me and zipped over to my side.
Father, do you need anything?
Ignea, Ren, I'm glad to see the village is coming along. Hard to believe nearly 5,000 of them managed to survive in those conditions, I said, looking around at the people. I knew that mortals were able to adapt to the harshest of conditions. Even on Earth, us humans never knew when to give up. Still, for over 5,000 of the mortals to survive in the undead-plagued North was nothing short of impressive.
We are a strong race, my lord,
Ren said with a bow. She had matured greatly since she was put in charge of the beastkin. She sort of had to, considering I'd basically dropped her into the position. Still, I was glad she was taking to the place. I don't think I would have trusted anyone else at that point with the beastkin there. They likely wouldn't have taken too kindly to being forced under new leadership either. I have no doubts on that. Is everything proceeding well?
Yes. We had a few troublemakers that caused some issues a week or so ago, but they were dealt with. Sadly, I had to put them down. The unholy mana just had too strong a grip on their minds.
I shook my head at the news. Unfortunately, we'd had to put down close to 300 of the beastkin that we rescued. As Ren said, the unholy mana possessed too strong an influence on them. Casualties of war, which is exactly what we're in the middle of trying to clean up. The necromancers will be getting desperate soon with so many of their plans failing. I want you to keep an even closer eye on them. I have no way of knowing what happened to the necromancer that caused this, I said, looking over the pitiful beastkin. I couldn't feel any control links, which I had come to understand quite well thanks to Rockruss and Julie. But when you think you're the cleverest one in the room, you usually find out you're not.
I understand and will. I do have an issue,
Ren said, then pulled her massive two-handled sword off her back. I did a double take when I saw the poor thing. It was barely maintaining its shape. If someone had been struck by the thing, it would have amounted to more of a blunt strike than a cut.
Is there anything you can do to fix it?
Fix it, I said, letting the words hang in the air. I took the weapon from her and observed it more closely with my dungeon sense. I could see why she wouldn't want to just replace it. There was quite a bit of her mana in the weapon. To her, it would have felt like an extension of one of her limbs. I concentrated on the mana, making sure it kept its shape while I pulled out the metal. In Ren's case, she preferred to have a decent amount of weight in her weapon. Pulling in some of the new material from my storage dimension, I infused it with some mithril. I mainly used the mithril to give the blade an edge, as mithril was quite light, but made the main structure out of orichalcum. I swung it a few times to test the balance, and the blade sang as it cut through the air. I handed it back to her, and she did the same thing. It was about the same size, but now had a gray, flat blade with a green edge. She gave me a smile before sheathing the blade.
Thank you, my lord.
No problem. Keep up the good work, I said, then turned to Ignea. As you know, I'm about to investigate what is happening on the moon. Our sensors did not pick any dungeon energy up, but I wanted to cover my bases. Should my consciousness be trapped in another battle, you are in command, officially this time.
Yes, father. I won't let you down.
You've made me proud since the day I summoned you. Try to help out little Lena. I know she's technically older, but she seems more like a younger sibling for you, I said, patting her on the head.
Don't worry. Lena and I get along.
I smiled, then nodded. Sounds good. Next, I teleported to the dockyard. The dock automata gave me a salute, then went back to work. I looked around at the fleet. It was time to get some answers. Launch! Chapter 4. Operin's Wanderer.
It should be around here, somewhere,
I mumbled
as I tried to find the switch. It was basically a miracle last time I found it. Though, right now, I was just glad to finally be away from the trolls and kobolds. I don't know what they were looking for, but they didn't stop for rest once, even after 2 days. I lost sight of them at the beginning of the third day. I just couldn't keep the invisibility, acceleration, and detection magic going any longer. Even I had my limits. Once I stopped to rest, they quickly outpaced me. I still found tracks of their passing while I made my way down the tunnel, but by my estimate, they were several kilometers ahead of me already. I was particularly happy when I found my turnoff in the tunnel and found they hadn't taken it. Nowhere in the beneath was truly safe, but it was better moving away from the trolls and kobolds. Thankfully, the less deep you were, the safer it was. I stopped checking the wall for the switch when I felt a tremor. Bracing, I prepared terra magic and breathed quickly, my heart racing, until the tremor passed, then released the mana. Quakes were one of the scariest events that happened in the beneath. I'd rather not have several tons of stone fall on my head, and placed my hand on the wall to catch my breath from the small scare, then heard a click. On the other side of the space, a perfectly square door appeared as the stone receded into the corners of the square. It was an interesting setup that didn't require magic. There were ruins that contained many things like this scattered throughout the beneath. This was only a tunnel entrance that led to the surface. I'd explored this area at least a dozen times, but couldn't find a larger complex. Yet given how I found the lever, I could have just been missing something.
Caw, caw, caw.
Yes, I find the Arcaran's technology to be fascinating as well. How I wish we could have found something more, I replied. The Arcarans were an ancient race that once ruled the planet. No one was sure what had happened to them. Be it their magic, technology, or culture, all evidence pointed to their being a higher level than current known civilizations. The question was how a civilization like that could just disappear. I quickly made my way across the cave and into the new tunnel. Only a few seconds later, the passage closed. The first time, I'd nearly gotten myself killed while examining the doors when they closed.
Caw!
I'm sorry, okay? I didn't mean to crush your wing that time. Will you just let it drop? I said, rubbing the bridge of my nose. Kez the Fire Raven would constantly bring that up to get extra mana.
Caw!
Well, thank you. Let's get going. Once we get to the surface, we need to figure out what the hell is going on, and most of the people we knew from the first time will be dead. That was one of the downfalls of outliving the surface mortals by nearly 500 years. All the friends and contacts you made eventually died off. A day later, light that I hadn't seen in almost a century met my gaze. Vines had grown over the entrance, so it was slatted, but it was still sunlight. If the city of Fallen Rose hadn't possessed a light source of similar brightness, I wouldn't even have been able to see, just from the minor exposure. I sent Kez out first to find out what the situation was around the entrance while I adjusted to the light. An hour later, Kez reappeared and gave me a rundown of the surroundings. The ruins that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.